Today we'll be talking about life cycle assessment, which is a way of understanding the impact of various different objects on the world around us. So I want to start off by using the example of an iPhone. In fact, Don and I right now are shooting this video on an iPhone, and here you see a picture of an iPhone. And this is an example of a technology that is in use by millions of people around the world and that has a lot of different impacts on the world. So there are a range of different impacts. So on the one hand, it affects the ways in which I communicate. It changes how much I use my landline. I actually don't have a landline anymore. It affects the mining of different materials around the world. And so there are all sorts of different impacts of different types from each one of these iPhones. So first off, there are materials that it's made out of. It's made out of various bits of glass and different metals and coltan and all sorts of different kinds of stuff. And these materials need to come from somewhere, and they need to be shipped together, and then they need to be transformed and assembled in very specific ways in order to have the functionality of an iPhone. And in particular, that manufacturing process needs to be at a very high level of precision. It's very easy to make a circuit board in a way that doesn't work, and so many of them get discarded in the manufacturing process. iPhones also lead to a variety of different substitutions. So for example, there are people might not write letters because they instead send an email. And so this shifting of communication and of style of communication can have a very big impact on the world. There are also a range of interactions that this device has with other aspects of the world. So for example, I use my iPhone for navigation, and that keeps me from having to drive extra distances because I can now map out my route from place to place and not get lost as much. Albeit Don and I did get lost on our way up to visit Ruth McGiddo for one of our videos. So one of the mechanisms by which you can assess the impact of a given piece of technology, or any other thing actually for that matter, is called life cycle assessment. And life cycle assessment is a process that involves four main elements. The first is called goal and scope, and this involves specifying the object of study. What is it that you're trying to assess? The second is an inventory. So this is a process of data collection and modeling where you go through various different aspects of this object and do an impact, do an inventory of the kinds of impacts it has. The third is called an impact assessment, where you evaluate the contributions to the various impact categories that you defined. And the final stage is interpretation. So based on your values and the values of the stakeholders, is this impact, you know, how does this impact compare to the impact of other things or what you were expecting? So with regard to the goals and scope, the core question is what impact categories are you trying to assess? For example, are we assessing air pollution? Are we assessing the effects on particular species or ecosystems? One real challenge with life cycle assessment is how do you decide where to end the analysis? In terms of the iPhone, are we assessing the change in quality of life of the people who used to work in the post office before the post office laid them off because fewer letters were sent? Is that within scope? Often it's not. That at some point you have to draw a boundary, because at the extreme of it, everything is connected to everything else in at least an indirect way. And so at some point, to do a meaningful life cycle assessment, you need to scope the problem. You can't deal with every possible interdependency that exists. With regard to the inventory, the question is, how do we collect the data? What's our mechanism? How do we go about finding out this, these measurements of the world? And how do we predict future effects? That's one of the things that modeling is good for, computational modeling in particular, is taking the way things are now and projecting them into the future and seeing how it is likely to emerge. The third category is impact assessment. So how do these data and models allow us to populate the various impact categories? And the final one, in interpretation, you have to figure out who are the stakeholders in the system and which stakeholders get to decide which levels of impact are acceptable. And the question of who is a stakeholder is a really important one. Ultimately, in an iPhone, I'm a stakeholder because I own one. Every Apple shareholder is a stakeholder because they benefit from the production of iPhones. But for example, in the production of coltan, which we'll be talking about more later on, there is mining that goes on in the Congo. And are the miners in the Congo stakeholders? I would say that they are, but at some point, is it, you know, is the family of the miners part of the a stakeholder? And at some point, you need to scope the problem and draw boundaries around it. So one way to think about the impact of different products is called cradle to grave, looking at it from the moment that it's dug out of the earth. So effectively, it's cradle, using a metaphor of a living thing, that it's dug out of the earth at one point. And then these raw materials are transformed, and they're made into a consumer product, and then the consumer product is used, and then it's eventually put in the trash, and then enters the waste stream and goes to a landfill or is recycled. And this process is called cradle to grave. So from the beginning to the end, it's movement through the productivity cycle. However, there are some architects named McDonough and Braungart who have suggested that there's a different way you should think about this. Rather than cradle to grave, you should think about it as cradle to cradle. That every waste stream from every product should be the input to a different production cycle. And this way, rather than looking at it as we dig stuff out of the ground, we use it, and then we throw it away, looking at there being these cycles of connectivity that bring all of the different products into connection with each other. So looking at IT systems, what are some of the special resources that IT systems use? They use an assortment of raw materials, so metal and plastic, to make the devices themselves. They also use quite a bit of power in order to make them able to do the things they do. And what I mentioned before, coltan is a mineral that is mined in the Congo. And this has the mining of coltan is done under one might say, questionable circumstances. It's heavily implicated in the civil war that's going on in the Congo and in various different human rights problems that exist there. There are also a variety of environmental implications. So for example, there are endangered gorillas that are sometimes eaten in the process of by the miners of coltan. So in terms of the impacts of IT, there are various different production processes, so the manufacturing of the chips and all of the different pieces that go into it. There's also the packaging and the distribution of these products. And these take place across wide distances in the world that, for example, the coltan is mined in the Congo and it's shipped to China where it's manufactured and then it's shipped to the US where I use it. And that is its production. It travels quite a bit of distance. And so one of the impacts is all of the fossil fuels or whatever energy is used to do all of that transportation from one spot to another. So something I'd like to ask you to do would be to go find a video. They're called unboxings. Go find an unboxing video of your phone or some other piece of technology that you use regularly and watch it with an eye to the materials used. For example, with the iPhone, they talk about the beautiful suction that comes from the box as you lift up the cover. And they go through in loving detail all of the different objects that you might find in that box. But I'd like you to look at it for your phone or other device with an eye to where those things came from. Where did the iPhone come from? Or where did the plastic that forms the box come from? Or where did the inks that go into the printing come from? Where did all of these aspects that aren't even part of the iPhone, they're just the window dressing, just the packaging for it, where did they come from as well as the device itself? So this gets into a question of carbon footprint. This is how much CO2, how much carbon dioxide, which is the main greenhouse gas, is emitted into the atmosphere because of that device. And this then is a piece of how much CO2 is emitted because of everything else in your life. The food that you eat, the devices you use, the transportation you engage in, the technology that brings this class to you, the energy that you're using to plug your computer in. All of these things contribute to the carbon footprint that you have on the Earth. And there are other questions about whether or not certain things should count as part of your carbon footprint. So for example, if you're a US citizen, should you be accountable for 1/300,000,000th of the carbon footprint of the US government and the US military? If not, who's accountable for that? So computation is a growing part of people's carbon footprint. Right now, computational devices, information technology, takes up about 2 to 2.5% of the energy that is used around the world. So the computational footprint relates closely to the carbon footprint. The bigger your computational footprint, the bigger that chunk of your carbon footprint is. So on a lot of people's emails, they have, especially business people, they have a little tagline that says, please consider the environment before printing this email. Because a lot of business people are sort of old fogies who the first thing they do when an email comes in is they have their assistant print it, and then they put it on their desk, and then they look at it on a piece of paper like they were expecting. And so please consider the environment for printing this email is meant to be a way to keep people from using up so much paper. But given the computational footprint that various different ways of living have, I wonder if it would be interesting at the bottom of your email to say, please consider the environment before using this internet. You know, how does the IT that we use affect our carbon footprint and then our impact on the environments in which we live? Thank you very much.